So my name is Valmik. I'm a software engineer at PayPal, and I'm really stoked for speaking at GitHub. This is the second time, and I'm thankful for the SF Node guys for letting me come here again, allowing me around this premises. The thing is, GitHub has the best sound ever. I have done this kind of a talk elsewhere. Wherever I've gone, I've never gotten a sound which is equivalent to GitHub sound. It's just fantastic, and hopefully we're gonna have a... So there are only two things that can happen tonight. Either we are going to have a good time, or I'm going to screw up spectacularly, because nobody makes music like this. Either ways, I mean, if I screw up, you guys will have a laugh, and you win, any which ways. You know, if we have a good time, or if you laugh, you win. So the reason, okay, before I go on, actually, is there anybody who produces music, plays music, or whatever? Okay, quite a lot. That's not bad. And is there anybody over here who writes JavaScript? Oh, wow. Almost all. So what I want to tell you now is all of you are able to produce electronic dance music, at least after this talk. I've created this library that I want to present tonight, which will let you use string and arrays and then string and array methods to produce electronic dance music. It's called ScribbleTune. It's written in TypeScript. I recently wrote it in TypeScript. It has a bunch of methods like sessions and stuff. I've used Ableton Live for getting a lot of inspiration in terms of what kind of methods I want to provide in this library. You can use chords and scale names directly in your code. And there's something called patterns, which I will discuss a little bit at depth on the next screen. Like I mentioned, you can use string and array methods. Since it's made of strings and arrays, you can use the string methods and the array methods on top of your patterns to create intricate stuff. So that you can have, So you can use string and array functions. The other item is you can use it either in the browser, that's what I'm going to present today, and as well as on the terminal. So the TypeScript module transpiles to a Node module that you can import and directly produce music from the terminal. At the same time, you can import it, use some Webpack or Parcel or something like that, and transpile it to a JavaScript file that you can then import in your browser. And perform that way. And the last thing is, it also produces a JavaScript file, which is on a CD in JS. So let's say you don't want to put in too much time in exploring how this thing works. You can just quickly use JS Bin or JS Fiddle or CodePen or what have you. And then you can use the CDN file, and you can try out the methods. And the last point is, it solves all your problems. I have a very strong feeling that I may not be able to get into that segment, but if I do, I can assure you it solves all your problems. All problems are interpersonal relationship problems, by the way. So it can help you in solving all those problems. And I hope I can get into that if I have time. I want to be respectful about the next speaker as well, so that's why I'm saying that. So so ScribbleTune is, I must mention these three modules, because without them, I don't have ScribbleTune. It began with the first one, that's called JS MidGen. It's by a guy called Dave Ingram. He's SRE at Google. He produced this. He created this pure JavaScript library that lets you create MIDI binary files that you can import into software such as Ableton Live, Reason, Cubase, even GarageBand. I used that library, put my pattern language on top of it, and created a very easy to use interface so that you can produce MIDI files from the terminal. The talks that I gave initially used to do that exactly. I would produce MIDI files, import them into Ableton Live, and produce a live track on the spot. What I realized soon is that I'm talking about open source software. I'm inside GitHub, which is the biggest proponent for open source, and I'm using $1,000 software for producing the music. So I had to get out of that, which is where the second thing comes into the picture. That's StoneJS. That's by this guy called Yotam Mann. He's from New York. Brilliant programmer, very nice programmer. He's put together this wrapper for the web audio API, which I will discuss a little bit. StoneJS is just fantastic. So I'm using StoneJS as a dependency so that I can take my pattern language into the browser, and you can produce full-length tracks and perform them right in the browser, which we will do tonight. And then lastly, chords and scales. Excuse me. So there's this library called Tonal by this guy called Danny G. He's from Spain. Initially, I had written all the music theory code inside ScribbleTune itself. But then I soon found this library, and I realized there's no point in, you know, having two things doing the same thing. And in the spirit of open source, let's use what already exists. Let's not reinvent the wheel. If you want, you can contribute something to that if it doesn't exist in that repository. And I switch to Tonal. It gives me the music theory that I can use inside my module. And then some. Web Audio API. I must take a moment for Web Audio API because this is this has changed spectacularly what you can do in the browser. Web Audio API is not necessarily new. It's been there for a while. But the thing is, it used to use this thing called script processor node in the browser. It is a call-based event system. Nothing wrong with that. The only problem is it would run in the same thread as your UI stuff is running. So the user is moving the mouse, dragging something, clicking something, all of that, single-threaded, right? It's running in the same thread. That event callback system is running in the same thread with callbacks. There's nothing wrong with that, but it introduces a very important bad thing, and that's latency. In music, if you have latency, you don't have music. You need precise timing. So what Web Audio API did since Chrome 60, at least, about a year ago, they introduced the same activity which script processor node did, which is basically to give you lower level access to the machine. They moved it to audio web workers. So what that does is you have two different threads now. One is for your UI stuff, what the user is doing and whatnot, and the other is the audio web worker running on a different, completely different thread, processing audio. This gives precision. Without precision, you don't have music. Music needs the perfect timing. Even if it is crappy music, it needs perfect timing to be even called music. So Web Audio API to the rescue. And like I mentioned, Tone.js is the wrapper that I'm using for Web Audio API. OK, patterns. I'm going to take a moment for describing what patterns are. excuse me. This is a simple 5 or 6 character-based language that I've put together that you can use in your code, basically a string. And the last item over there is a new feature that I've put together. Every time I give a talk, I come up with a new feature. In a way, if there were no talks, my library would have had the only one feature that I created 5 years ago. So this is a new feature that I'm going to present today for the first time. But let's start from the top. X stands for note on, and minus stands for note off. For folks who dabbled with music, you may have played with a step sequencer at some point. So step sequencer is like a tool by which you can, like, you know, take a bar of music. Now, what is a bar of music? Or a measure of music, or let's say 2 seconds of music. Let's say you divide that into 16 parts. Now, that is your steps, 16 steps to complete this one bar. So this X and minus lets you define note on and note off events for that duration of one bar of 16 beats. I'm using 16 as just an example. It's not necessary it should be 16. It can be 32, it can be 64, it can be 8, or it can be 4 as well. But I have noticed that EDM producers generally talk about, they talk in the 16-beat paradigm. So that's why I use the example of 16 beats. The square braces are for subdividing an existing beat. So let's say you have a beat which is of a quarter note, and you put square braces around it, you can divide it further. This sounds very weird till we do some actual coding. Once we do the coding, you'll realize what I'm talking about. But basically, because of this subdivide, you can create intricate patterns from the X and minuses. And the last is R, random. So what happens is, if anybody tries to produce music like this, the way I'm trying to show you, the chances are you're going to produce a lot of monotonous stuff. Monotonous stuff is an essential aspect of EDM, because it lets you create that, you can drive towards a high of some sort. But you need to be careful. If you cannot break that monotony every now and then, you do not have music. So the purpose of introducing R is to break that monotony. And hopefully I can present that in an example. Make some noise. Finally, this is what I was waiting for. So I have a couple of projects. One will use the CDN version of ScribbleTune. And it will outline, like, if you want to quickly get started with ScribbleTune and do some stuff, you can use this. I'm just going to start a Python web server over here on port 3000. And open it up over here, right? I have two buttons over there. I hope you can see them. There are two buttons over there. The reason for putting buttons is, for security reasons, Web Audio API will not let you just directly start music on the load of the page. They need a user action for doing that. So these start and stop buttons are going to act as our UI element where the user can kind of click and do stuff. Before I go and make a fool of myself, let me check if the sound is on. AJ, I hope you're with me, man. So this is a point where you get to get a first taste of what I mean when I say GitHub sound. And hopefully I'll be giving you a lot more of it. But let's start like really small. AJ, I'm counting on you. Okay, sound is on. So that was a closed hat sample sound, right? Then I have a cymbal kind of sound, right? So these are not loops. These are just singular sound samples. Here's a kick, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to use that X minus R, that weird little five character language that I showed. We're going to put it together in such a way that it sounds a bit rhythmic. That's the idea. So these are the sound samples. I'll just move over to the code now. Okay. So I have this index file which kind of loads those two buttons and loads ScribbleTune from CDN. And it has this file. It has some commented stuff which we can look into later. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to start typing some code and show you how easy it is to get started. So the CDN version of ScribbleTune exposes a global method called Scribble. I don't recommend using this method or this way of producing music, but like I said, if you want to just get your hands dirty and quickly try out stuff, that's good enough. So let's do Scribble and use the first method of ScribbleTune called Clip. Clip is like a container for a musical idea. It can be a melodic idea, rhythmic idea, harmonic idea, whatever it is. It's like a container for your musical idea, and you can pass an object to it. It just got one argument, the object, and that object can have multiple properties. One of them is sample. Let's use a sample file for this. And let's use kick.wave, the kick that I made you hear just a few moments ago. And then we'll give it a pattern. Let's say the pattern is just X for this example. So since we're in the context of the browser, I'm using Tone.js behind the scenes, Tone.js is going to give me a loop when I execute that. And hence, since it's a loop, it's going to keep on going over and over again. This single X is the same as doing multiple X's. It's the same thing. It's not really different because it's a loop. Unless you introduce an element like a minus or a R or something. So to start with, I'm just going to do X. And then this is going to give me a sequence that I can start. Okay? That was prettier that adjusted that thing. Actually, just one single line if you go to see. Prettier made it into four or five lines. And then we go back over here, reload the damn thing. And then if you play it, right? This is the sound I'm talking about. So we can do more of this, right? We don't need to be limited to just one sound sample. As I said, these are sound samples. And instead of kick, we'll take a closed hat sample. That's called just ch.wave. They're just right next to me over here. And then we'll use another pattern. I'm subdividing a, by default, a X is a quarter note of length by default, but you can subdivide it with those square braces. Now it becomes 2/8 notes because it got divided into two. And now if you play that bit, it becomes. Yeah, and let's keep on going. Let's add one more to this thing. Oops. Let's add one more to this. And let's make a snare, open hat sound, why not? And maybe we can do it something like, we can subdivide this further and make this open hat pattern like this. Yeah. And let's add a snare drum to it so that we have a full beat. Okay, snare. I have all these wave files already sitting in the same folder. That's why I'm able to just use them directly. And we will have this pattern for the snare drum. So if we had a sufficient quantity of beer, that could pass for music. Right? Let's say I had a crate of beers. I know that's a lot. If I had a crate of beers, I could totally groove on that. Right? A crate of beer could help me do that. So the objective for tonight is to reduce the amount of booze we need to consume in order to make something acceptable. So one way to do that is, some days ago I came across this this guy who's called Ethan Hine. He's an adjunct professor of music in NYU. He put together this spreadsheet. I hope, yeah. What he did is he put together some classic breakbeats in 16 steps. And he, if you can see, what he's doing is he's got these filled cells to denote a note on and empty cells to denote a note off. To me, that reads like x minus x minus 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 x and so on. So what I did is I transpiled all of that into a JSON file. This is how it looks. Each of these files is just a representation of that thing. And I have just, instead of doing this each individual clip, ultimately it's a drum pattern, right? So instead of doing this individual clip, what I'll do is I've got this variable called loop. It has four instruments, just like from that Excel sheet. And then I'm just looping over those and creating a scribble clip out of it. If I play that, do you see the number of beers going down now that we need? That is the whole objective. We are going to reduce the number of beer we need, amount of beer that we need. So that is a quick example of how you can use this. And before I go on to the next segment, what I want to show is maybe some melodic aspects. So far we've been just dealing with rhythm. Let's try to deal with a melodic aspect of things. So I'm going to create a clip. And to start with, I'll just create and I need to introduce one more thing over here called samples. So earlier on, I did something called sample, which took a single wave file. Now I'm going to say something like samples and give it samplers.piano. Before I move on, I'll tell you what that is. So these are my sounds. I have these samplers. So for example, piano, I have these multiple wave files. Each of them coincides with C or D or E or all the notes of the octave. So for example, it's just a single note. Right? Multiple notes like this. And I'm going to use these different notes to produce something melodic. So I use samples, samplers.piano, and I'm going to use a pattern. For now, we'll just call it a single X. So it's a quarter note. Every quarter note will play one of those samples. And now we need to tell ScribbleTune what are those samples that we want to play. So I'm going to use a method in ScribbleTune called scribble.scale. Like I said, you can use scales and coordinates directly in ScribbleTune, and we'll stick to the key of D minor, just for the heck of it. C major is too cliched, I guess. So that's why I said, let's do D minor, and then start. Let's just see how that sounds. It's going to sound quite idiotic, actually, but it's fine to just start with. And what we'll do is, we'll double that thing. We'll take this guy, and we'll do one more version of it. And in here, we'll keep the same notes, but we'll change the subdivision. So for example, it's a quarter note by default. Let's make it 8th note. So what happens because of that is, it kind of divides that quarter note into 8 notes. And now if you play that, so some amount of melodic aspect is coming to the music now. Still, we need a lot of beer, because we can't still tolerate that, obviously. So let's continue to... And another thing is, right now we are in this context of a browser with just a button over here and some code that I'm writing. What we want to really do is to be able to use the browser to create a application that helps us produce and perform live as well, you know. Can you imagine a DJ doesn't come with a turntable, just the browser? So that's where we are going. That's where we're going to try to go. And I think we can get rid of this guy. So I'm going to open up another project. I'll close this guy. We can get rid of the Python server. And then this is another folder that I have over here. I'm using Create React App. So Create React App is a very nice utility. I'm sure everybody knows about it. It's very famous. It's like a nice little thing. You don't want to get worried about the tooling and whatnot. You can directly start playing with your components, start building your app, start dealing with your business logic. So I'm using Create React App to power this. I'll just do npm start. And here, it should already open up on its own. Are you doing it? What the hell? What is going on? This has to happen, right? Okay, so I wonder if it's visible. on some of the screens it is visible, but on this one it's not so much. If I mouse over, you can see that these are all various clips, and these are channels. These are various channels. And towards the right, can you see that button over there? What it's supposed to do is, it's supposed to play the entire row of clips. These are supposed to be clips. They're all empty right now. We're going to fill them up. So this idea is directly from Ableton Live. Ableton Live has this session view where they give you this columns thing where you can insert clips, and then you can either trigger the entire row of clips, or you can individually click through and play individual clips, and in a live kind of an environment, you can produce something interesting, hopefully. So we're going to do something like that. So right now, as you can see, these are all empty clips, and I'm going to fill at least half of them to get started. So let's do that. And what I've got over here is, where is my GQL file? OK, so the way I'm looking at this whole thing is that this is a GraphQL. So I'm using GraphQL for managing the client state. So far, we've been using Redux, obviously. And some of you may have started using Apollo for the client state. But primarily, we've been using Redux or some other client state management paradigm. So lately, a lot of companies are investing a lot of money, talent, time, energy into GraphQL. So they have this whole paradigm where there's a network, single network request to an endpoint, single endpoint, where you can get your state, and then you can paint a picture on the browser. So what happens is you make a query, you get the data. You want to update some data over there, you want to change something, you want to mutate something, you send a mutation, right? So you do your queries and your mutations, you get the data, you paint the picture. But for painting the picture, suddenly you context switch into Redux, where you want to do reducers, you want to do actions, you want to do this map state to props and whatnot. So suddenly the way you're dealing with data has completely changed. So the idea here is use the same lingo for getting the data from the server and mutating over there. At the same time, whatever data that you have on the client side, that client store, use queries to get data from there to paint the picture. Or if you want to update that client store, use mutations for that. So that is the objective. For the sake of this set, I have these four mutations, and a single query. So the idea is the client UI state, this guy looks like this. If there were a couple of clips on him, he'd look a little bit different. So the client's UI state has changed. So we'll use mutation to change that UI state. And at the same time, if you look at an EDM track or a track that you're going to perform or produce or whatever, that track also has various states. It has an intro, there is some outro, there is some middle part and all that. And you're going from one part to the other. You're trying to trigger one clip over here, another clip over there. That is a mutation on the track. So I have these resolvers for those mutations. My resolvers are, where are my resolvers? No, not this. There. So I have these resolvers over here. So one of the mutation is to start or stop a track. So that is a state of the musical piece that we're going to play. Either it's stopped right now, like it is right now, it's stopped right now. We're going to change the state of the track to it is playing right now, right? It's a state change. Same with the UI. For start and stop, there's a button you'd want to show some visual element to suggest that, oh, the track is playing now. Same applies to the clips. Each of these clips, you can, okay, there is no clip over here. Let me add one clip quickly. Okay, so what I've opened over here is, it could have very well been a JSON object. It's a JavaScript object literal. But what this is it's just a definition of what samples I want to use. So these are the various samples I'm using for the cake, for the bass, for the closed hat, for the open hat, and whatnot. And these are the clips. As you can see, they're all empty. They're just empty objects. This is my state. This is my client state. And I'm using Apollo over here in my provider. This client that I'm providing to the provider is just writing this track, this initial track, which is completely empty as the initial state of this store. As you can see, there is no URL parameter over here because I'm not making any server requests. I'm managing the entire state only on the client side. And if you go back to this GQL thing, one very nice thing, important thing to note is this client directive. Everyone has a client directive. What that means is, please don't make any network call. What I'm trying to get at or what I'm trying to mutate is on the local store. That's what that client directive means. So we are managing the client store with queries and mutations, and we are managing the track with queries and mutations as well. So just to drive the point home, I'm going to take one of these examples over here, and I'm going to write a pattern that we can play with. So we'll do a simple pattern for now. Just this, and how about and we'll subdivide it further. Now you can see that one of the clips has got active. That's because I've changed the store by hand, and it's active now. And it has this play state ready for us. We can click it, and we can play it. If we play, maybe I should start this first. But if I click it and play it, and now it's gone into that state where it says you can stop it as well. And it stops now. And the other thing about ScribbleTune is that it will not just abruptly start or stop. It will consider the BPM that you're going at and accordingly start on the next beat. It won't just abruptly start something like that. And I'm using, obviously, Tone.js behind the scenes for making all this happen. So that is one clip I put over there. I'm going to repeat this clip a bunch of times. My aim is to create at least half of the track manually like this. Second half, I'll just, because time is a constraint, obviously. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring in some sound effects. EDM tracks are incomplete without sound effects. So I have some sound effects over here, if I can show them quickly. If I go to GitHub Live, all this is in my GitHub, so if you want to take it later on, these sound samples and everything, it's all available, you can take them. So samples. And let's take this effect sound, OK? Yeah, that's all the sound does. Or another sound. Yeah. So I'm going to use the so I'm going to use these sounds. And again, I'm going to use that X minus X and that R, that kind of a paradigm, to produce the loop that I'm going to play. So let's start with the FX that we heard. And another thing I can introduce at this point is, OK, let's start with the first one. And the pattern will be, so for the next 3 or 4 minutes, this is going to get seriously boring, because I'm typing into a JSON file. I'm not doing anything beyond that. So this can be really boring to watch. I'll try my best to speak in between and all that, but I'm warning you, it's going to get really boring. But after that, we will have reduced at least 3 beers that we need to listen to it or to tolerate it. So the first FX I'm going to use is this pattern. And then I'm going to introduce one more property for this clip called subdiv, which we used earlier to divide the pattern, but this time I'm going to extend the pattern. Instead of having a 16 note pattern, I'm going to have a full measure, because it's a special effect, it's a longer effect kind of a thing. I want it to go over the entire bar. So let's do one M. M stands for measure, one measure. If you have not dabbled with music, it may not make so much sense, but a simpler way to look at it is that now you're provisioning a little longer space for that effect to play itself. And what we're going to do is we're going to just repeat this a bunch of times. Because EDM is all about repetitive music, right? So it's repetitive, so it's totally fine. As long as we can break the monotony every now and then, we're good. So I'll do it like 5 times, because I want to do it. I want to make at least half the track. There are like 10 clips, 10 rows over there. And then I'm going to use this pattern for another pattern. And this one is going to be like this, 1, 2, 3, 4. And again, we'll do the same thing about the subdiv. Is going to be one measure long. So that's how long this pattern is. And I'm going to repeat them again. So let's repeat this. Oops. What the hell am I doing? OK. Yeah, that's good. So I've got 5 of them. Yeah, that's 5 of them. And there's this impact sound. That's going to be like the underlying theme of our intro. And that's going to sound really nice. And it's like one whole bar of just this. And we'll repeat it sparingly. We won't repeat it to me. I'm sorry, someone said something? Semicolon? Ah, oh, yeah, yeah. Thank you so much. We're going to see more of this now. And I'm just going to use it here and here, comma. OK, so you guys can be my JSCS or ESLint. So we'll get into the piano part later. So I have some of this stuff going over here. And let me add a kick drum sound on the fourth. And the kick drum sound is going to be this pattern. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. On the eighth one, we'll do some variation. And we'll bring in R, the new feature that I wrote for this particular talk. And we'll continue it with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And we'll do another variation at the end over here. Yeah. And for the bass, we will do, we are in the key of D. So notes can be, we'll just have a single note going along with this pattern. And the pattern, I'm going to introduce R again, obviously. And this time I'm going to add one more property to it called random notes. So R works in two ways. One is either it will randomly decide if it wants to do a note on or a note off event, or if you give it random notes, it's just going to pick one of those notes. And what we'll do is, for the random notes, we'll give it the D minor scale again. So D2 minor. Yeah. Okay. So I think we've got what we want. And now if we look back at this guy, so it's kind of filled up now. I just hope I haven't screwed up. Because I haven't heard any of it, right? Yeah, it seems fine. It seems fine. So what I've got is I've got a bunch of clips on some of the channels, and I've filled it like halfway through. That was my aim. The rest of the half, we'll just pull in stuff. So when I do talks before, they folks ask me, like, do you practice this stuff, or are you just typing whatever that comes to your mind? So obviously, I'm not typing whatever comes to my mind. In fact, even real musicians, they practice like hell before they go on stage and play anything. Even impromptu stuff, they've practiced for years, and then they've gone and played something impromptu. If they haven't been doing that, they're not performing anymore. So yeah, so I know what I'm doing. I mean, at least to some extent. So this is how we're going to start. I had these three sound effects. I made you guys listen to those sound effects. So we'll start with those sound effects. And we can obviously stop clips. And then let's bring in a snare drum. I'm waiting for it, for the right time. Let me know when I should drop it. Should I drop it? I think we have reduced the amount of booze that we need a little bit more. Shall we reduce it a little bit more?
Yeah.
Furthermore? Okay, so now what I'm going to do is, I'm not going to keep typing like this because it will get seriously boring as I start getting some melodic elements into this and typing it by hand. So I'm going to just get in something that I've already put together, which is more or less on this line, on these lines, and hopefully it will coincide to a large extent. And I'm just going to use that instead to drive the point home. And I'll just walk through some of the new things that I introduced. One is, obviously, I'm using chord names directly in the code. These notes, this D minor, B flat major, and if you have played with music, dabbled with music, it will make sense to you that these are chord names. And then I've got this new method called ARP. ARP stands for arpeggio. So arpeggio means you take a chord, take its individual notes, and play them individually. And the interesting thing about the ARP feature of ScribbleTune is that, so let's say you have a chord, and let's say it's made up of three notes. So you can tell ScribbleTune that I want a count of eight. So it'll take three notes of that chord, take 3 more notes from the next octave and put 2 more from the even the next octave. So now you have 8 notes, and you can give the order of the notes that you want to play it. So what that translates to ultimately is that you have an endless options for creating arpeggios of various styles. I'm using the piano instrument like I showed some time back. I'm using the piano instrument to play some arpeggios. I've also got a saw, super saw kind of a sound. Again, these are individual sounds. So we are, at the moment, we are creating a very cliched kind of a EDM track, right? So no cliched EDM track can function without a proper saw sound. So I've got a saw sound as well. So there's a saw. And there is a kind of a pad kind of a sound. So to take the cliched paradigm a little bit further, so we have a pad kind of a sound as well. So these are the only few things that I introduced for the rest of the track. And if you go from the top again. Yeah, it's pretty much the same thing that we put together. It's like a clap sound kind of thing. You guys should know now when the drop is going to come. Yeah, now. Thank you so much. Really means a lot to me. Yeah, so I guess that's it from my side. If there are any questions or whatever. Yeah, sure.
Do you
going to do that? Oh my God.
I mean, I think he could catch it.
Do you have any plans to support non-sampled synthesizers? Like
oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. The support already exists. Just for the sake of this presentation, I depended on samples. But since I'm using Tone.js as a dependency, you already have synths, you have effects. And if you can visit scribbletune.com, there you can, see, for example, actually I can show it to you. And there are multiple kind of apps that you can make. OK, this guy has gone into like. So here's some code that I'm writing chords with, and I'm using a synth to play it. So it's a similar thing, right? I'm using ARP and whatnot. Yeah, so that kind of stuff. You can use synths, and you can put your patterns and notes and melodies and stuff using synths. Yeah, so you can totally use synths. But that's a good question, yeah. I believe you produce, that means. Any other questions?
Are you actually one of the members of DAPA?
Yeah, where's my mask? No, yeah, man, thank you so much for that. Yeah, so another thing I can quickly show is, it's not just about producing music stuff. You can even produce applications. Now, this application doesn't produce any music. You can have, it's like, it gives you tablatures for if you're practicing some scale or something, like C, Mixolydian or whatever, you can refer to this and sit with the instrument and kind of work your scale out. It works for the piano and also for the keyboard. So if you're using a computer keyboard for producing music, you can just reference this and use it in your productions. So that's another way of looking at it. Yeah, and that's scribbletune.com if you can take a look at it. And if possible, you're sitting inside GitHub, right? Star my repository. So right now I have 2964, almost 3,000 stars. There are about 200 people, I think, tonight. So 3,200, shall we put an ETA for midnight tonight? 3,200? Please go home and star it. Okay. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. If you want some questions, I can answer them later.